Ready to hear from our keynote panel, which will focus on the theme of connectivity for all from coast to coast. To head this panel, we have one of our industry's two true visionaries, I call him, Iain Gillott, founder and president of IGR. Iain is uniquely talented in identifying new challenges and has a remarkable ability to know where the market is heading next. I know not everyone appreciates the sports references as much as I do, but one comes to mind, and that is the extraordinary hockey player, you know, Wayne Gretzky, was always known to have said, the secret to his success was skating to where the puck was going to be, not where it had been. So Iain, I guess, is a Wayne Gretzky of the wireless world, right? He's always a move ahead of everyone. So we invited him to come today and show his stuff, and we gave him some really bright thinkers on his panel that hopefully it will test him and his ability to keep them all on track. So Iain, I'm going to turn the keynote panel over to you, and thank you for joining us with all the panels. I'll let you introduce the panel members.
Great. Thanks, Steve. Every time he introduces me, I'm never quite sure what he's going to say, because you know, my bio was written by my mother, so it's a little. My son is the big sports guy. We were talking backstage. He's a big basketball guy, and he's in college. And he actually had Gonzaga to win on Monday. So the whole family, my daughter's in the UK. We're over here, and all of us were watching the game, rooting for Gonzaga, just because Jordan gets in a really bad mood when he loses, and he had the potential to win $500. So that's about as close we got to the to the sports this week. So we've got the panel here. What are we going to do? So a couple of housekeeping things here. A, we can't see anybody because the lights are really bright. Okay. We didn't get the makeup on, so if you've got a lot of shining off the heads here and things, it's, you know, we didn't have time to get made up. So what we're going to do for questions, we do want to make this an interactive panel. We've got until 10 o'clock. I've got questions for the panelists to kind of move the discussion along. But what we're going to do, rather than have people with microphones that we can't see, I think they passed out some different cards. I see them flying around now. So if you'd like to write down any questions you have for the panel, we'll take a couple of times during the session to come collect them, and then I'll work them into the discussion as we go here. So what I'm going to do first is I'm going to ask each of the panelists here to introduce themselves and just tell us who they are, what they do, who they work for, etc. And along that process, answer the question of what do they see as the biggest problem to overcome in order to connect rural America from their perspective. So we'll start things off that way. So we've got Jay, David, George, and Steve on the end there. There should be an alphabetical order if we sat in the right place. Jay, I'll let you start.
Thank you for coming, by the way. My name is Jay Bluhm. I'm the Vice President of Development and Engineering and Planning for Sprint's Radio Network. I've been with Sprint for 19 years. I worked for our CTO, Dr. John Soft. So the question was, what is the biggest challenge for rural America? I think it remains the same with the low population density, with what I would call the current revenue streams. The challenge is still monetizing network investment to get connectivity to the customers that are frankly very spread out, and the challenges that still exist today. And I would just offer that as you look at the technology advances of LTE Advanced and coming with 5G, from a unit cost perspective, the cost to deliver a bit on the equipment and the, call it the software side, continues to decrease and decrease and decrease. What's actually not significantly changing is frankly the services model in terms of, you know, siting issues, at lease zoning issues, et cetera. So there needs to be a lot of progress in that area.
Okay, great. And we'll get into some of those issues. David?
All right, David Debrecht. I work for Nokia, and I'm going to one-up you, sorry. I've been working for Nokia for 21 years. So the original Nokia, not the Nokia, Alcatel, Sint, Motorola, Siemens that we are today.
We all have those stories.
I hear you. So what do I do? I'm the CTO for the U.S. majors customer team, which basically that means all the customers we have in the U.S. other than AT&T, T-Mobile, Sprint, and Verizon. So not the big four, but everybody else, which is basically everybody in this room. What do I think the biggest problem is, the biggest challenge is? Very similar to yours, but I would put it a little bit different way, is getting all the pieces together. Definitely, there's technology that'll bring the solutions together. There's money available, whether that's money from the customers or money from the government with CAF II or other incentives. It's just getting it all together into a package that's actually beneficial. So very similar in terms of a business arrangement, and it's more of a business problem than a technology problem.
Okay. George?
Good morning, everyone. My name is George Reed. I'm Senior Vice President for Products and Solutions and Marketing with Huawei Technologies in the U.S. here. My responsibilities are around new product introduction and solution development, as well as pre-sales, post-sales, technical support, and also branding and marketing in the U.S. for carrier products for Huawei.
Isn't that everything?
Sorry?
Isn't that everything? Is there anything else left?
It's all the carrier products. Enterprise and devices are a different slice of the business. Same thing, to me, the biggest issue for the rural operators is it's how do I balance, how do I trade off the costs for deploying networks and services in my rural areas, given the topologies that I have to deal with and the low densities, population densities. So it's, as you said, it's a business. You have to look at what is it going to take me, what's it going to cost me to deploy a service, a technology, a solution, and what can I gain from that? What's my revenue? So it's a business case analysis, and there's funding available, which is a good thing. I know Steve spoke about it a little bit earlier. Mm-hmm. There's some dynamics going on from the funding side with the new administration, but hopefully those will work themselves out and there'll be more money available to do these networks.
Okay. Steve.
Yeah, hi, I'm Steve Zitnik, Chief Technical Officer for Interop Technologies. I think you know, a lot of you, I know a lot of you, are our customers, and we're happy to be here and, you know, speak to kind of the issues that you guys face every day. I think going last, and when your name's Zitnik, you pretty much always go last. You know, I get the pleasure of agreeing with my colleagues. It is essentially an economic issue, right? That's the biggest issue we face. We bring a lot of tools to bear in order to change the economics. Technology is evolving, as we pointed out. There are public policy issues. There are spectrum issues. I think we'll talk about all of those today. But at the end of the day, it is simply an economic problem to solve. We need an ROI. There are very few of us in the room who are probably .orgs. Pretty much everybody here is a .com. Trying to return money to their investors, trying to make a profit, and we've got to find ways to make that happen using the tools of technology and public policy and spectrum and a number of things we'll talk about.
Okay, good. So the next question, you get to go first.
There you go.
Yeah, I know it hasn't happened to you much.
No.
We talk about connectivity. You know, I live in Austin, Texas. I go up to Colorado a couple times a year. You drive through West Texas, up through New Mexico, there's some long stretches there with nothing. You get into Colorado, there's lots of places in Colorado with nothing at all. My son goes to California for college, and he drives on I-10 from Austin to LA, basically. So instructions to get to college: leave home, get on I-10, turn right in LA. That's it. That's all you do.
Easy enough.
Even he can't get lost. But it was interesting, the first time he drove out there, my daughter and he drove together, they were streaming music the whole way. Yeah. One of them was playing DJ, and I did get the bill afterwards and looked at the data usage, but they were streaming music, and sometimes video actually, all the way on from Austin to LA, which is pretty impressive when you think about it.
Yeah.
And if you've been on I-10 out there, you know, there's a lot of trucks. There's not much else. So coverage in those respects makes a lot of sense. In other places, of course, it's much more difficult. Mm-hmm. I guess let's start this with the discussion then with what do the consumers want here in rural America? The people are out there. Is it any connectivity they can get, or you know, don't give me anything if you can't give me high speed? Right? Mm-hmm. How do you look at the markets?
Well, I don't think that there's really any differentiator at all between the urban marketplace and the rural marketplace as far as what people actually want, what they want to do. Stream videos, connect with friends, do business. All of the drivers for connectivity, I think, are similar or the same between the two communities. The difference is, yes, do they want anything they can get? I think the answer is yes, right now anyway, right? But I do think that everyone wants what we'll call broadband connectivity. So, you know, FCC right now is what, 25x3 is what they define as broadband. And I think at least that connectivity, because things like streaming videos, you suggested, streaming music, not so much, but video certainly is a huge driver. And doing that at, on a 4K video, on a dial-up or DSL is sometimes challenging. So I think they would like to have as much or similar connectivity as we see in the urban spaces. And I think there's a lot of things that can be done. I think wireless is probably the most efficient mechanism to deliver that, as opposed to copper or fiber or something like that in a rural environment. But between the two, I think it's essentially the same use case for the broadband.
Okay. So, George, do you get different requests from different parts of the country for what the carriers are trying to deliver to their consumers, or is it ubiquitous across them?
Well, it's a mix, of course, because folks are in various stages of technology implementation in the network. There are some limitations on what can be offered versus what's available from a technical perspective. You know, it's still, I think, 10% of the U.S. population, so 24 million still doesn't have the 25/3, and that ratio goes up to 39% in the rural area. So there's still an issue of fundamental access to begin with, at least at the 25/3 rate. So are people, do they have to have unlimited bandwidth? No. Unlimited throughput? No. They'll take what they can get, obviously. And we are a society of consumers. So what we get, we consume. So the more you give me, the more I will consume. So it's a mixed bag across the environment.
Right. Okay.
The only thing I'd add to that, certainly agree with everything that was said so far. The only thing I would add is that I think everybody wants what the same, no matter where you're at. You want your connectivity as fast as you want, when you want, where you want, at all times. We want it mobile. We want it to be driving down I-10. We want it, wherever you happen to be. I know my son does the same thing. It's, streaming music. Even though we're driving in a car and there's a radio right there playing the same song, he's streaming it into his earphones. I don't understand it. But anyway, it is what it is. And the people are settling for less than what they want, and that's the problem. I think it's akin to, we've all heard the analogy, it's akin to the electricity service delivery in 1900s to 1930s time frame, when it was everywhere in urban America, but in rural America it wasn't until the New Deal and the government said, no, we need to get electricity to everybody. And I think we're in the same boat right now with telecom. We need to figure out a way to get it there.
Right. So you're in the situation of running the networks, yeah, talking to the customers, hearing from them, right? These guys don't get the phone calls, you do.
And then they get them.
And obviously you've got urban, you've got suburban, you've got rural customers, and you've got roaming partners. So do you see differences in those different constituencies?
There's absolutely no difference. And in mobility, the customers move around. Whether or not you're in an urban environment, they go to rural, they go to suburban. And not to be repetitive here, but the expectation in these areas is the same as it is in an urban environment. The only thing I would focus on, really, the main things, is they obviously want wireless connectivity. Two, it's really about connectivity and then reliability at the application level. And I'll use your example of where it gets been interesting as you talk about applications, is, well, I'll use your streaming audio or your audio example as an example. There's a blur now that happens between these applications, where I'll use Spotify, for example. Spotify is nonstop, it's an audio service, but it's nonstop pushing video at the application level, and if you want a decent experience at the audio level, you better have the minimum experience on the video level for that application to work. And so it's really about that consistency of performance and delivery at the application level and being able to connect at all times.
Okay, good. So do we have any questions, Lucy? Okay, if anybody's got any questions, Lucy's on the end. So, we mentioned spectrum, and I've got a couple of questions here on spectrum. The first one is, what's the ideal spectrum for rural America? And I think the answer would probably say anything that's free, anything that's available, anything that goes a long way. Probably start with, let's answer that one, it's easy. But the other thing I want to work into this answer, and George, we're going to let you go first this time, is where does millimeter wave play into this? There's been a lot of discussion, obviously, of millimeter wave trials for 5G, a home service. I think there's carriers now offering it. They use it when they can't get in fiber in. I think Windstream's done some stuff for quite some time. There's different options out there. But obviously, we're talking on a wider scale here. Somebody mentioned it, maybe you, Steve, that maybe the best way to connect rural America is not wired, it's wireless. So what spectrum, and then what role do you see for millimeter wave within this this picture? And Jay, you're going to get, you can talk from what you've got available, of course, and how it's all going to fit together from your perspective. So, George, you want to go first?
Yeah, sure. There's obviously a number of options available, both licensed and unlicensed. So I wouldn't limit the opportunity by singling out one that's not one that's going to work for me. I see it as tools in the tool basket. So I have low band, I have high band, I have unlicensed. So I think in the case of the rural operators, they use what's available. 3.5's coming. 2.5, Sprint obviously has a lot of 2.5, and they can share that with the rural community, if so inclined. But all the options are there, and I think whatever people can get a hold of at a reasonable cost is what's going to drive the utilization of a particular spectrum. High band, it's a great solution in a very limited area, geographic area. So I think the benefit from the millimeter wave solutions is just the massive bandwidth that's available mm-hmm. compared to the current bands that we have in place. So when you fast forward and you look at what are the types of services that I really want to develop and have massive throughput for? You talk about 4K, there's 8K, there's VR, AR, all those things are coming. And as we all agreed a few minutes ago, consumers, whether they're rural or whether they're urban or suburban, they all want the same kinds of things. So in order to be able to support those kinds of newer technologies that require high amounts of throughput, you have to go to a high band in this case to support it, and 28 gig, of course, is an obvious option there.
Okay.
So again, limited in footprint, good for indoors as well. But anyways.
Right.
Yeah. The thing that I would add, I completely agree. I think what I would add to that is it really depends on use case. You might say the obvious answer is, hey, I want 600 megahertz. It's the lowest spectrum that's just recently been auctioned, not finished yet, and really has the best propagation. There's 70 megahertz going to be available, so that's good enough to get a real good broadband solution out there. But it really depends on your use case, so you need to start there. If you are trying to do a broadband to the home, that's one use case that might predicate use of XYZ frequencies. If your use case is mobile, that might be a different spectrum that you want to use, depending on your bandwidth and your spectrum that you're using. Millimeter wave, definitely of use in rural America. I don't see it being of use for access. I can see it being of use for backhaul. Mm-hmm. It is being used for backhaul today, so I see that continuing. I just don't think it has the reach for access. There's not enough home density in rural America.
They could have one, right?
Yeah. You own base station dedicated. Yeah. 500 megahertz.
So, Jay, you've obviously got a lot of spectrum. You're playing the balancing act and working out what goes where and all these things. So how do you look at it from a rural perspective in your network?
I think number one is coverage, right? So whatever regardless of technology, coverage is the key, and again, the connectivity. So obviously the 2.5 band, from our perspective, we got a vast amount. I call it the low band spectrum of 5G. So that clearly you start with any sort of spectrum strategy as it goes. It's really about use cases, and then it's about capacity. There's a large amount of capacity in low band 2.5 whenever we get to 5G. That's also a nice bridge from LTE advanced. Mm-hmm. And then when it gets to the higher bands, I think it is use cases, but I also think there's a timing aspect of when the higher bands are truly working through some of the operational technology issues that come with that, at least today. Those eventually will get worked through, but I think it's work on the use cases that is actually really needed, and to make sure that the rural community is looking at really use cases that can scale. Scale is really the key, and you know, the nice thing about the 2.5 band is it's a global ecosystem that you should follow. So in order to get to scale, you got to follow a global ecosystem, and I think that's really key.
Okay, right. Steve?
Not much more to add, I mean, to what the gentlemen have said so far. I mean, I do think that the 600 is key, in order, particularly in the context of a rural setting where you need some propagation. I also agree that 28, or millimeter wave stuff, you know, is more useful right now in a backhaul, as was mentioned, than it is necessarily, you know, for mobility coverage. A very small footprint for 28. It's, you know, down to like 200 meters or so, which doesn't really do well in a you know, in a broad-based area with a low population density. So, you know, I think as far as when we're saying, you know, what can we do to help connect rural America, I think one of the biggest pieces that we can do now is to clear that 600 megahertz spectrum and get that in these guys' hands. I think that's going to be a large help in that regard, simply because of its propagation properties.
Right. We've done a lot of work on millimeter wave, and we actually looked at a model that said, okay, if the tower height is, or cell site height is X, and use propagation, you know, a distance of, you know, 400 feet, or I can't remember, 400 meters, what you use, 200 meters, you can vary it. What population density do you need, home density do you need to be viable? So if you know all the costs, you can work it out. And there's actually a very well-defined little box that goes around the cost for those areas compared to fiber, you know, copper, whatever's out there right now. Mm-hmm. And I think it's going to be a fairly limited deployment. You'll see it suburban. Like my neighborhood, I probably wouldn't work. The other thing is you have to look at who the competitors are. If you're going run against a strong cable guy, or, you know, a Fios, a U-verse, et cetera, do you really want to be the third player? In other places, that doesn't exist. So I think it's going to be an interesting mix. So we did have some questions here. I forgot to tell you, by the way, Steve Berry is going to he'll pay $10 for every question. So if you write your email address on the back, these guys didn't, so I forgot to mention that. He'll Venmo you. See, the young people laugh, right? Because they know what that is. And they imagine Steve going, what?
And this older people with children dread.
And that's exactly it. I was just going to say, and we're all laughing because we've got kids who use it. Dad, just Venmo me. I don't do that, son.
Here, let me do it for you.
Yeah. He doesn't ask for Venmo when it's tuition time, you know? Have you noticed that? All right, I'm going to read this one out. And actually, Jay, I'll let you go first from the technology point of view. So soon, more machines than people will connect in America, but our processors and systems are mostly designed for people. What changes are needed to the network and IT worlds to accommodate the change? So talking about IoT, M2M, et cetera, et cetera. So not talking about the opportunity here, but rather changes on the network side and IT side that you see to make this happen.
Well, there are changes on the network side. I think it's really, I'm going to divert the question a bit. I think it starts with looking at what the use cases are. And where the specific use cases are going to scale to a point where that investment in those changes can actually happen. One thing in particular when it comes to IoT, I certainly think there's advancements in the transactional model to make sure that you're opening up to all kinds of applications that I would say, you know, people would pay for in a different way, not potentially a monthly subscription, et cetera. But the key to that is to actually get scale at the application, the use case level, so that, those investments can be made.
So it's back to the scale question, but now we're talking about sprinklers and tractors and
right.
cows and things.
Yeah, but I think it's really the transactional model driven by the use case to allow those scales, but also to open up the ecosystem to where different applications can ride on that network investment,
yep.
but customers actually can pay for it in different ways.
Okay. Steve?
I agree totally. It's going to be primarily use case driven. Because there's once you talk about connecting everything, right? Their use cases are different for everything. The cow is different than the self-driving car, right? So do we need you hear a lot of talk about a very low latency, very high throughput, which would be useful in the use case of the self-driving car, right? I mean, it needs real-time communications, obviously needs to do that with very low latency, where things like like meters you have out there or the cow or something along those lines, they're not really that reliant upon that kind of a network. So it is going to depend on what you're trying to actually accomplish by connecting something.
Right.
And that's going to drive the investment on the other side, so yeah. I agree completely.
And I think you could see different priorities in different parts of rural America as well. Mm-hmm. So if we take the I-10 example, you want a truck, self-driving truck going yep. down I-10. I don't know if you want that or not, but let's call it driver assistance tools going down I-10. Certainly you want low latency on I-10.
Right.
The cows at the side of I-10, they're really not that into latency.
And if I can comment again, I think the key, though, is to look at the use case, and then, frankly, it's by demand. So even though it's rural America, you may have an industrial situation where,
sure.
or a manufacturing facility that actually goes to automate and is using IoT, that may drive demand and then lower latency. So frankly, it's a bit of a combination of both, and it's not uncommon. Rural is not uncommon to metro areas from that perspective.
Right.
So I think the key is, again, to go back and look at that application level. And there's going to be hot spots of demand in rural America, just like metro.
If I can add one thing to the discussion here. Our legacy networks, 2G, 3G, 4G now, yes, IoT has been here. It's been here for a long time. And networks are capable of doing it at scale. No question about that. But the networks are really driven for getting access to consumers, actually consuming the broadband or the phone service or the whatever, the texting, whatever it was, not really towards IoT. I think 5G is the first time we're going to actually see networks that are developed specifically for IoT in a broad sense. Now there's other solutions out there that IoT is their focus. But 5G with the ability to do network slicing, I think, is really going to bring a key aspect to allowing the network to be adjustable to the use case, whether it's a phone use case, whether it's a broadband use case, or whether it's an IoT use case.
Right. Good.
So yeah, I think to address the question that where we started, it had a network, or it had a, what's going to happen to my network? And we touched upon it. So there's the devices piece, there's the radio part, and then there's the core part of the network and applications and billing. So it touches this kind of thing touches all parts of the network. In many cases, some of those pieces are already in place and they just need to be slightly adapted. In other cases, it will be a lot more. Just from the device side, we talk about we need to plant the device in some place. So there's how do we get the device on the cow, right? How do we drop that device on a sprinkler solution? How do I measure water leakage? How do I detect water leakage someplace? So those kinds of things. So there's that part of it. And then if you look in the core of the network, we all talk about cloud and evolution of the cloud. So that will play a key part of how this whole IoT side of the business rolls out. And we're all working on it. Systems are in place already in many cases, but there'll be a continuing evolution on that part of the network, which also implies perhaps a different business model that we all have to look at.
When you said, how do you get the sensors on the cow? Living in Texas, I had this view of this guy walking around with a shotgun, just shooting sensors onto cows. And there's a story on the web, and I'm not sure if it's an April Fool's. I think it may be a late April Fool's, right? So let's couch that. But the racetrack in Austin, the Formula One circuit, we had some very bad weather a few years ago, but they have these awnings over the grandstands. And they've been collecting water, and as they age, of course, you know, they can tear and they don't want the water. So they have this story that they've come up with this genius idea of how do they get the awnings to drain? You put holes in them. How do you get the holes a couple of hundred feet up? And there's a picture of the guy walking around and going, and the title was, yeah, only in Texas. Yeah, everything's solved with a gun in Texas. So. All right, next, we're going to play a little fun here. We're going to go down the line. You've got a one-word answer for this, and then we'll come back, and you can expand on it a little bit more, but we're going to change the subject here a little bit more. You can say help or hinder, right? This is from you guys, by the way, not from me. Is the current administration expected to help or hinder rural broadband?
They need to help.
Help?
You okay, too, very good.
You too or will.
Very good. Yeah, yes. Okay, very,
that was,
very
that political. That was my three-word one. Word.
I'm going to say hinder.
George?
I'm an optimist. Help.
I'm going to say help, too.
Wow. Okay, so you're the hinder guy, so you get to go first.
Yeah, it's a difficult question. I think the reason I said hinder is because, in general, we try to hit our constituents in a political environment, and most of our constituents are not in rural America. So it's an area that you really need to have focus on that's outside of politics. And I just don't think, see in our environment that we have today that's where the focus is going to be.
Okay. You get the three-word answer. I'll let you go next.
I'm not a government affairs person, but I've seen no indication that they're not going to be helpful.
Okay. Right. Steve?
I think I said helpful. And I think primarily the reason is, in my perspective, is both political parties right now are talking about the need to expand and repair infrastructure. And I think that's something that we're all on board with, but I think as part of that, there have been discussions about, using some of those infrastructure funds in order to accelerate the broadband rollout in rural America, because it's something that needs to happen.
Yeah.
You're going to build highways, you're going to build bridges. We also need the digital infrastructure in order to remain competitive as a nation. So I'm hopeful.
The cost of building a new bridge and putting in small cells and smart whatever is incremental when you're rebuilding the bridge, right?
Right,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Why would you not put fiber down the side of a road when you're rebuilding the road?
Why not?
Why not? George?
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same sense and agreement here. There's a need. There's an understanding there's a need to improve broadband. If you look at our, the U.S. in the context of the world, where we sit in the broadband availability spectrum is not where we want to be. We're not at the top, and part of that is because we don't satisfy the broadband needs of the rural communities. So there's an awareness in the government whether or not they do the right thing in terms of making more funding available. The FirstNet gentleman talked about funding, and I heard $16 billion for rural communities. So, how much of that happens, we'll see. But so I'm optimistic that there will be more funding available in the future.
Okay, great. If there's any more questions, let Lucy know. I've got a couple more here. I'm going to hold those until later on. Let's go back to ours. We hear a lot of talk about virtualization. Virtualized solutions, obviously, are you guys working on virtualized stuff? Yeah. The big carriers obviously have a different level of resources from a smaller operator. What do you see for virtualization? I mean, is there a role for virtualized solutions in rural America, or is it something we just need to, it's nice to have, but let's table it for a few years. We've got more basic problems to address. Whoever wants to go first. George?
Yeah, absolutely is the answer. Absolutely.
There is a need.
There's a place for virtualization in satisfying the rural community. There's virtual solutions in play today. There's virtual IMS solutions, virtual EPCs. All those things are available. And what needs to be done is to enable the rural community to connect to these types of solutions. And those things are available, as I say today. We're early on in the whole virtualization world. It's started over the last few years, as everyone is aware, and as we go through more and more implementations, we learn more, and these solutions become better tuned, finer tuned, and available for more and more folks in the marketplace. So I say absolutely, it's a need.
I'm sorry. Yep. I couldn't agree more that it's absolutely necessary, and it's helpful in a million different ways. You know, at Interop Technologies, you know, we have roughly, close to half of the community here is we're fortunate enough to have as partners, and we've been doing NFV for them for years. That's what we do. You know, we're a I'm old enough. We used to call it hosted or service bureau. Now it's all cloud based and NFV based. But it's absolutely essential. I think it's one of the things that brings the cost down in the network. And that's all part of, you know, we talked earlier when we started, this is an economic problem, right? So anything we could do from a technology perspective to kind of reduce the costs, reduce the amount of capital investment that needs to go into these kinds of projects is very, very helpful in the ROI. And so that's really been a focus of, you know, Interop for the last, 10, 15 years, something like that, that we've been building out these solutions and connecting them and offering them to our CCA customer base.
Okay.
Yeah, just one thing to add, a very specific example. I absolutely agree. But the example I have is, in the past, most of the big carriers have been driving us to scale up. They had millions and millions of customers, and they wanted us to scale up as vendors to allow them to roll out and deploy solutions for that large of a base, which is completely opposite of what rural America needs. You don't need a device or a network that can scale up to 100 million subscribers. It doesn't make any sense. So scaling down is also a problem. So now with virtual environments and virtual machines, you can actually scale down and put an entire 4G core network on a single rack unit device. So that makes it very economical and very easy to deploy in rural America. So I think absolutely virtualization is going to be key.
Okay. So Jay, you are virtualizing.
Yes,
you are one of the big guys.
Yes, we are.
And you've got a bunch of smaller operators here. What advice for them, if you were in their shoes, having been through what you've been through with virtualization, et cetera, what advice would you have for them?
I totally agree with David. I think a lot of the rural operators are at a bit of a sweet spot to actually leap to virtualization because of the kind of the step function that's coming in demand in technology. As in terms of investment, they can kind of ride on what's been done in this space up to this point. And to your point, you know, virtualization offers the opportunity to, frankly, scale down at an efficiency that actually gets over some of the monetization issues that they've experienced in the past.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, any words of caution? Any things to avoid? Like, wish we hadn't done it that way?
No, not necessarily. I think the key is there's been so much work done in this area. We've done a tremendous amount of work. And it made tremendous progress is to frankly piggyback on the work that's been done by others. And right. there's a lot there.
Yeah. So just follow.
And we're certainly there to help.
So just follow the food chain.
That's
down.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Okay. Any more questions? Oh yeah. Okay. I think Steve just sent me a text. He's up to $15. So. I don't think he's paid anybody in the past. In the last year, I've offered that before. I don't think anybody's ever been paid by him. Just saying, you know. Okay. You're a rural operator today. You've got to start somewhere, improve coverage, access, service, solutions, products. What would you start with? What do you have them do today? If you walked out, all these people are going to go home to their bosses. And he's going to say, what did you learn at CCA? And they're going to say, there was this great panel called Connecting America the Beautiful, and David said, I need to do this. What would that thing be?
Bummer. So I'm first, huh? It's a tough one. I think I'd go back to one of my first answers, and that is, you need to define your use case. There's a whole lot of ways to try to connect America the Beautiful. But you need to figure out how you want to do it and what you're trying to accomplish. And until you do that, you can just churn and churn and churn and churn and churn. There's always going to be the next big thing. There's always going to be a 5G, a 6G, a something coming down the road. But if you don't make your decision right now on what solution you want to provide, what business you want to be in, and where you want to play, you're going to continually churn and get into analysis paralysis. So my advice would be to decide today what your use case is, what environment you want to play in, and then from there, choose your technology and move forward and not wait for that next big thing, because it's going to be, example for today, 5G is not going to be here until 2020. Okay. It's going to be played with, and it's going to be toyed around with, and it's going to be slowly rolled out, but really ubiquitous coverage or even strong commercial coverage isn't going to be here until 2020. It's too long to wait. Right. So move forward.
Okay. So have a strategy, pick something, execute.
Yep.
Okay. Jay?
Well, I'll bridge on top of your comments. I totally agree, but I think the key, again, is the rural carriers need to be organized about it and work together, because scale and following a global ecosystem is where the key is.
Yeah.
So as you're looking at the use cases, look at what is a bit common across sort of rural America, and there is a lot of commonality, and to use the big carrier partners in that, in actually doing that. You know, CCA provides a great platform to actually get that organization together and start really working through what the high value use cases are to where you can actually get to the scale to where it's economical.
Okay, good. George?
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, everybody here speaks with each other, so you gain insights from your friends here in the community in CCA as to what kind of services and use cases that they have. Piggyback on what larger operators are doing. Also engage the vendor community. We're happy to help you work through business models. Happy to have you gain from the experience that we have in working with either other rural operators here in the States or elsewhere in the world.
Yeah, I would just agree with the group. You know, I do think CCA is an awesome opportunity. You know, I've been fortunate enough to. I'm getting close to 20 years coming to these shows, which is great. And one of the things that I think is most powerful about CCA is the fact that, you know, we don't have a number of, there's not a lot of overlap between the operators here, right? They're geographically dispersed. They don't necessarily compete with each other that much. So it allows and fosters an environment for, you know, collaborative thinking without some of the competitive issues that you might have, you know, with the national carriers. So using that power, I guess, to focus on what's next, what are we moving forward as a community on, I think is going to be very beneficial in defining the use cases, as we pointed out, and where we want to go next.
Right. So I'm going to follow this up a little bit, and I'm going to exempt you from answering this. You'll understand why. So I would argue that T-Mobile has been fairly disruptive in the last few years with the whole Magenta and, you know, being fairly, now you see why I'm letting you know. But they've been fairly, you know, they've been fairly disruptive and taking kind of the edgy approach to the market and upset things and push things, right? Is there a role for a rural operator, a smaller operator, to do the same thing in their market? Can a small operator who's got a part of a state or a state be that edgy and confrontational? Because I see a lot of smaller operators having to follow, you know, AT&T's done unlimited. You did 50% off. I know an example of this where you're Sprint delivering phones to homes. You know, one of the rural operators got asked for the same thing and started a similar program. It was a follow me type thing. Is there an opportunity to be edgy and disruptive on a small scale?
I'll venture to go first, if you don't mind. I would say the answer is yes, but not necessarily in the way that you're thinking. And what I mean by that is I think there is an opportunity to be edgy and to be bold and brash, but it's against your competitors, and your competitors aren't the national carriers, I don't think. I think they're more partnerships there and that you could make
could
and
be.
Cooperation could that you... So your competitors are probably more the people that are trying to deliver services similar to what you're trying to deliver that aren't necessarily the national carriers. So I think there absolutely is, but you have to kind of look outside your own particular industry to determine who it is that you're trying to be edgy against.
So you're saying that a rural wireless carrier could be competing with the telco, the rural
Correct.
Telco.
Right.
They could all be competing with AT&T, Sprint, Verizon, et cetera, they could be partnered with them, right? Roaming with them. So, okay.
I think in a sense, though, you know, just knowing a lot of the community, depends on what area you're talking about, right?
Yeah.
In a lot of cases, you know, that I know of, these operators are competing against four or five other people in the marketplace, most of which are the big four, and that's who's there. So I do think that there's a ability, there's always an ability to be disruptive. I don't think scale necessarily makes that a differentiator there. You know, I think edgy is maybe not you know, what a lot of folks are comfortable with. Certainly not T-Mobile edgy. You know, I do think there's an opportunity. I do think there is a way to do it. I'm a technologist, not a marketing guy, so I don't know exactly what that means. But I do think there's opportunities. There's always opportunities to disrupt.
Okay.
I'm actually going to jump in here.
Okay.
I'm going to challenge the assertion that being edgy is synonymous with delivering a good customer experience.
Ah.
I think the key is actually being close to the customer and understanding what they want, what they need, and when they need it, and to be innovative in that and get close to your customer base. Mm. And that's where you're really gonna compete. So it's really about delivering a good customer experience and not being edgy, so to speak.
Yeah. Don't be edgy for the sake of edgy, just do the
deliver to your customers and make business simple for them, make it simple.
Right, yeah, good point. All right, I'll let you go on to the first one. Next, timeline for Volte and Volte roaming with rural carriers.
It's coming.
Okay.
Currently being worked through. It's certainly something that needs to happen. We're working on our plans and frankly working with our partners. That's as specific as I'll get. The only thing I would add to that is when it comes to I would call the roaming experience, there's been a tendency in the recent past that as new technologies, in particular roaming, are dealing with partners, that tends to be an afterthought. And we need to kind of move that, accelerate new technology from a roaming perspective to where it's either at the same time or a very fast follower.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
5G, that's the work we're doing.
5G is going to have a similar problem, right?
That's right.
It's gonna, it could be even worse.
Not to have, whether it's domestic roaming or international roaming, is to push that along from a standards perspective, from a partnership perspective, to where it's not lagging by a year or two or even beyond that.
Right.
Yeah, nothing really to add there. Definitely, it's not a capability issue. It's not a technology issue. It's just a matter of getting it, get the systems in place and getting the agreements in place to make it all happen, so.
Yeah, I would agree the technology's there. I think there may be some device shortcomings at this point. That cause stumble in that area, but otherwise, things are ready.
And whenever I see the word Volte, I always take my opportunity to make back Volte call and have it serve it. It's taken me many years to practice that.
It's pretty good.
I always hope there's a Volte question because I get to do that. Who's got kids? Have you noticed how your kids, when they don't want to answer that question, like, son, how are your finals, right? Or you know, they always go, oh, what, you're breaking up? Mm-hmm. No, I'm losing you. No, the connection. Or they just pause the video connection, you know, FaceTime. Just pause it. Have you noticed that? Try it when they're asking for money, right? I've done this. Dad, oh, sorry, what, you're breaking up? Works every time. You can blame Wi-Fi all the time, it's, especially in my house. So, let's see here. Question here on fixed services. Okay, and we've touched on this with millimeter wave. I'll read the question and we can expand it a little bit. With 5G and new spectrum, will the role of mobile carriers expand to include more fixed services? So I'd actually change this and say, is there a role here where the mobile operator, I'm going to use the word dominant, is the dominant provider in rural America over a traditional landline, or is now the time where the two need to get together Are we past that point? So let's change it into, we've got this question here, but what's the role with fixed services with a mobile operator in rural America? Anybody want to go?
I'll start.
You want to start?
And it goes back to your earlier question. I think the key in the future is customers want to be mobile. And I certainly think there's a blurring that's happening between how we define a fixed service versus a mobile service. Mm-hmm. In any service, they want to be mobile. So as long as they're connected and get a decent experience, the customer doesn't care whether or not you define it as a fixed or a mobile service. They want their applications and the service to move with them.
Right. So we're the ones in the industry who say that's a fixed
that's
service.
That's right.
Yep. Okay. Good point.
Yeah, I'd just add that I think the opportunity is there for all the operators, whether you're a wireless operator, fixed operator, cable operator, or some other kind of operator. I think the opportunity is there with the spectrum becoming available, the technology where it is today, and coming together, especially when 5G is going to be a core network that can connect to any access type. I think the opportunity is there for anybody to get into anybody else's space. So it's going to be very interesting. I can't say how it's going to turn out, but it's going to be a very interesting thing to watch play out.
Okay. George?
Yeah, I see fixed definitely as a part of the offering. I said earlier it's a tool in the tool basket. So whatever you need to deploy to satisfy your customers, some of those will be fixed only customers. Some will be their traditional mobile customers today. As we go forward, maybe those blend nicely between a fixed and a mobile service. But it's just another element you use to satisfy your customer needs.
Yeah, I would agree with that as well. I think there is a big movement. When we talk about fixed, we tend to think copper fixed and fiber fixed and things along those lines. I do think that the opportunity is very large on the wireless side of it, whether that be traditional LEC or something along those, getting into wireless, purchasing spectrum. But definitely with the, when we get into LTE-A and we get into, the millimeter wave stuff, the amount of bandwidth that we can now provide over wireless is just growing leaps and bounds every year. Begins to challenge what you can do, on a piece of fiber. There's been a lot of, talk and rolling out, not necessarily rolling out yet, but about gigabit LTE is happening right now. At that point, why lay the fiber? Why use the copper anymore? So it's a merge, it's a meld of the whole thing coming together. But my personal opinion is that the wireless operators will become the dominant providers of all IP services. Mm-hmm.
I've had this company for 17 years. We just do wireless market research, wireless and mobile. It's all we do. We've never did fiber, cable, any of that. And now we do fiber, cable, all of that, because it feeds mobile networks.
Right.
And when I started this 17 years ago, I was an analyst before that, wireless was tiny. One of the first forecasts I did was for 15 million subscribers in the United States in the early 90s. And wireless was 5% of the telecom market. Mm-hmm. Sprint was, you were a telco, right? You were long drop, pin drop guys.
That's right.
And way back when. And now wireless is the telecom market, to your point. The fiber supports wireless. If you mm-hmm. don't, fiber providers lay fiber for the wireless operators. Real estate, towers, it goes on and on and on. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting. Take it forward another 25 years, what it's going to look like. Wires? What are you talking about? We had those? Yeah. So, all right, I've got one more question here, then we'll wrap up. And I'm going to change this one round a little bit. We all started this discussion by talking about declining population in rural markets and sparse population densities, and you've got to have scale and all these challenges. Is it viable today, and I'm being confrontational here. Steve, you're going to go first, by the way.
All right.
Seriously, though, can you survive without rural America? Can you have a viable business that says, I am not going to connect to rural America. I'm just going to do the urbans, and I'm not going to go further than that, and that's all I'm going to do?
Well, I think It's kind of an interesting question. Yes, you probably could. But in a mobility sense, and you know, it's that national footprint is a big deal, right? So yes, you can focus on the urban areas, but you better have good roaming partners in the mobility sense. You know, the money, the population density helps drive. I've read articles that the cell site average revenue per cell site can be up to 1,000 times difference between an urban environment and a rural environment. But you still need that national footprint, particularly in the mobility sense. If it's just fixed, or what we're calling fixed here, to the home, you can do that. Cable operators do it now. They're MSOs. They have a specific area they work in, and that's fine. But as soon as you introduce that element of mobility, then the national footprint,
the
you can't do that.
Changes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I see it as an integral part of the fabric of the United States. If you look at the rural areas in particular, there's a lot of agriculture, there's mining, there's timber, there's oil and gas, there's manufacturing, and if we don't support those with whatever technology, but wireless obviously is a great solution for the, from that perspective, then we diminish the ability to help grow, I'll say, the overall U.S. environment, as well as now you're restricting folks from earning a living and surviving without connectivity in a particular part of the country. So I think absolutely we have to have and support in a big way connectivity in rural America.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to go a little further and say that the answer to the main question is no, I don't think it's possible to have a viable business case. And I'm not going to say whose service I have personally, but I get very frustrated when I travel, because I travel to all of the rural operators and other operators that aren't the traditional four, and I get very frustrated when I pick up my phone and I don't have service. So I think it's actually integral that you really need to have the rural America covered, not only for business people who do travel, but also for the other people who visit family and travel, but also to tie it back to the other keynote, public safety, FirstNet. Mm-hmm. I think it's absolutely required. Mm-hmm. And it's, as a society, it's something that we have to do in order to provide a safe environment for our people.
So I'm not expecting you to say, no, we don't need rural America. So the question then becomes, what role, you obviously partner with these operators?
Yeah, we do partner with the operators, and it's really critical to us. Back to the point, mobility requires you to be good in rural America. The other thing I would point out is, I think rural America and businesses and industry in rural America, when it comes to future IoT, is an untapped opportunity. And I think what the rural carriers need to be really focused on is how do you monetize that? And I think there's a step function in efficiency and productivity that can come out of those industries in the future.
Okay. All right, we've got a few minutes left here, so we get the lightning round again. Steve, you're going to go last.
Okay.
I know you'd like it there, so which, Jay, means you're up first here. And you know this question's coming, because I send an email to them. So this is the what keeps you awake at night question. You cannot say indigestion, children, spouse, okay? But really, what keeps you awake at night regarding connecting rural America, the subject today? What decisions or indecisions do you think we're making now or not making now that are going to come back to us in a few years and just bite us in the butt? And we're going to say, darn it, we should have done that then. What do you think? One thing, I'll give each of you 30 seconds. Jay, you ready?
I think the cost structure associated with deploying infrastructure needs to be fixed. And that doesn't just apply to rural America. It's the leasing, the zoning, the construction costs to get to a cost structure that is actually affordable for the rural carriers.
So you're talking about the process we go through to put it, let's say, a
that translates into real money from a services perspective. To continue to be organized around collectively changing that model.
Okay, good. Even with my interruption, 29 seconds. Before that, you're 19 seconds. Very good. David, you ready?
Yep.
Go.
I think what keeps me awake is doing nothing. That's what I worry about. There's no silver bullet now that's going to be right for everybody. There's no silver bullet coming with 5G There's no silver bullet coming from any other place. You need to do something now, decide what you're going to do, and move forward.
Wow. 18 seconds. All right, George.
So it's an education perspective for me. It's sharing knowledge, collective knowledge, from our interactions with the rural operators here, with urban operators. It's just putting that information in your hands so you can make intelligent business decisions on where you want to go. And we just need to do a better job at it. And this is part of that process.
Okay. 24. All right, Steve. You get the last word.
Yeah, well, oh, fantastic. Well, I agree with the fact that, I think that the thing that keeps me awake and is worrisome, I guess, is indecision, right? There are a host of, as we pointed out, both technologies and services that are coming down the pipe here. And I think in a lot of cases, we end up with that deer in the headlights look, like, okay, what am I going to do next? We've got all of this stuff out here. I would agree with David that, do something, get moving, start moving. And I think it's natural, right? I mean, there's a lot of new technologies. There's a lot of new services on top of those technologies, and you've got to pick which one is right. But if we do nothing, then nothing will get solved.
Okay, you were 46 seconds, which I normally cut people off at 30, but since these guys gave you 10 seconds each, then you're in good shape. So, all right, thank you very much. This is great. I want to thank the panel. I think you'll be around for the rest of the show. If anybody has any questions, come grab them. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thanks for coming. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Iain, thank you so very much. Appreciate our thought leaders, and I know that if thought leaders and determination of our effort continues, we'll soon have coast-to-coast coverage, hopefully. I would like to tell Iain that I did text him while he was up here on where he could find that $15 and it should be in somewhere near his hip pocket, so FYI. Listen, we have a really great opportunity here to recognize some excellence in marketing awards. I'm really pleased that we...